Let me preface this video by saying, no, I'm not a server or networking specialist. I may be training as an infrastructure technician, but I'm far off having those abilities or skills yet. But in today's video, I'm going to be showing you guys how I built up my family storage NAS. What purpose it serves, the various iterations and testing processes I went through, and how it's ended up now.
Thanks, that was fun. Don't forget, no regrets.
So, why did I need a NAS in the first place? Well, as a content creator that has been on this platform going on 10 years, and as a bit of a data hoarder, I have a lot of full project files for videos that I've worked on over the various years. Not only that though, I wanted a shared area for my family to access things like, well, family photos and such. For that reason, I needed something that was going to be reliable and have some form of failover if I needed it. Casting back to 2018, I set out to build my own NAS out of an old HP box I had laying around. But besides the point it only had a single 3TB drive inside, I didn't have any money to sufficiently put into this project, meaning I cut plenty of corners in the process, not something you want to do with a long-term storage box. I ended up abandoning this project pretty quickly. The next iteration moved on to some more appropriate hardware, a Synology Disk Station DS220J, the teeniest and cheapest NAS I was able to find at the time. Running two 2TB drives in a RAID 1 configuration, it's perfect for a small home network with ordinary household usage. But pretty quickly, I ran out of space. At this point, I had the perfect opportunity to expand. With me wanting to learn more about how server hardware and software operates, I invested in a HP Proliant Microserver Gen 7. Sporting an AMD Turion 2 Neo and 8GB of DDR3 ECC memory, along with 4 front swappable drive bays populated by 2 4TB drives and a 60GB SSD. While not fantastic, I purchased this machine for a spicy £82.99, mainly to complete those basic file sharing needs, along with a Plex server, and in some ways, this system was even overkill for that. Right, well now that I've got through the backstory of my network attached storage boxes, it's time to move on to present day. This is what I am now rocking, a HP Proliant Microserver Gen 8. She's trying to save me. The generational gap between my former Gen 7 and the newer Gen 8 brings a much better and newer Intel-based architecture with a socketed CPU, not soldered. Although I wouldn't exactly call our Celeron G1610T a massive upgrade, but I'm at least at the point that brings me much better expansion and upgradability. We've got 16GB of DDR3 ECC memory to play with this time around, meaning plenty of headroom for anything I would plan to be running on it. In terms of network connectivity, it's got 2 gigabit network ports along with dedicated HP ILO. If you don't know how this works, it basically provides a web portal in order to view the status of how the server is running and can even give you a way of remotely controlling the system at a BIOS level. I've also thrown in a 10 gigabit SFP network card for future experimentation, which I'll probably cover in an additional video. So the next step is for us to talk about how I plan on configuring this system for my day-to-day use. Starting off with physical hardware upgrades, I wanted to boost the performance even just a little bit with a new CPU. This is the Intel Xeon E3-1220L, which set me back only £20. And well, looking at the multi-threaded benchmarks, it almost doubles the performance. So that's a more than welcome upgrade. Next, the exciting part, storage. I say exciting, I screwed up a little bit. So I'm sticking with the existing 2 4TB drives and 60GB SSD for the boot drive, but I've thrown in an additional 8TB drive into the mix, which cost me just under £100. Unfortunately, I forgot to read the fine print of it being a 5400 RPM drive, meaning our general read and write speeds may not be up to scratch, but at the end of the day, with this being a storage server, I'm not overly concerned that this will get in the way. Moving on to our configuration, I'm using a copy of Windows Server 2019 Data Center, 110% activated of course. Now, just like my Plex server video I did a while back, I'm sure there'll be some confusion about not choosing something like Linux, but once again it came back to something I was more comfortable with setting up and getting working for now. As we've got two network ports to mess with, I've nick-teamed them together in order to create a theoretical uplink to the network of 2 gigabit. Obviously, we're still on a gigabit network, so the speeds won't necessarily increase, but when two different computers are accessing off of it, they will individually get their own gigabit link. Now, because our drive configuration isn't ideal to do something like RAID 1, I'm instead using a bit of software called DrivePool, which I picked up a copy of for £22. The main premise of this software is to quote-unquote pull a set of physical hard drives together into one big virtual drive, where a file will get written to multiple disks. So as long as all the disks don't die, you'll still have that file protected. In my configuration, I'll obviously have the two 4TB drives along with a single 8TB, giving me a total usable space of 8TB once file duplication settings are enabled. This is pretty cool for someone who's not that technically minded when it comes to all the various editions of RAID. The idea of being able to throw a load of drives that you have laying around into one big shareable volume is quite handy for some, but obviously the risk is reliability of those drives you are throwing together. As my drives are of a fairly reliable source, I'm not too worried on that front, but I'll always keep a cold archive spare of the data in addition. So to finish on the topic of the current configuration, I'm going to run some benchmarks, mainly looking at CPU memory and disk drive speed. Let's get straight into it. So starting off with Crystal Disk Mark, we pulled off 223 megabytes per second on the read and 139 megabytes per second on the write, which certainly isn't groundbreaking, but this is a storage box that's just meant to hold files, so at the end of the day, this doesn't really matter. Next up we have Cinebench R23 with a multi-core CPU test where we scored 737. Now, compared to other CPUs on the list, this will look extremely weak, but keep in mind, this machine is more meant for power efficiency, being a storage server and all, so at the end of the day, this performance score is perfectly adequate for a storage server. And to finish off our benchmarks on this system, we have Geekbench 5 with a single core score of 338 and a multi-core score of 770. So this leaves us with the final topics to close on, how I plan to improve, and some projects I would like to use this little box for. Now keep in mind, I'm going to be dreaming of an ideal world in this segment. A lot of it is impractical for a home network, but would be nice to experiment with one day. Starting off, I think the microserver is fine for future expansion. While it is an older version of HP's low to mid-range enterprise lineup, it's still plenty powerful for anything I plan to do on it. I wouldn't mind redoing the drive situation at some point. While SSDs are definitely way off my price bracket for now, and the fact that I wouldn't really see that much of an improvement being on a gigabit network, but one day I might like to experiment with that. But for now, I'm going to source two new 8TB drives at 7200 RPM, of course, as I'm only using about 5TB on the current NAS, and I think that amount is going to last me fine for now. But if I do need to expand in the future, DrivePool does allow easy expansion, so that's not a concern of mine. If I do swap out the drives, however, I've still got the old Gen 7 microserver, so it would be nice to throw the drives in there and have a little off-site backup, or even just have the additional server located in another part of the house. Once again, a bit impractical for a home network, but would be nice in an ideal world situation. And finally, another thing I'd like to play with more is virtualization. As I learn more about how server hardware and software operates, I never really understood the benefits of using virtualization, as I used to just load up random VMs on my laptop, but now that I can see a genuine use case, it would be cool to have a little play and see what I can get running. So there you go. I hope you all found this video informative, and if you did, make sure to leave a like. If you didn't, I would say leave a dislike, but apparently in the time that I've been gone, YouTube decided to get rid of that. So if you have any feedback for me, make sure to leave it in the comments below. I'm Owen, thank you all very much for watching, and I'll see you in the next one. Goodbye. Escaping home, where my music's